God, we've gathered here in your name. Here we stand, God, in faith. Help us to focus now on you and your love for us in Christ. As we worship you, teach us this morning to rest in knowing that you are for us. In Christ, all things have been made right. God, we humbly ask that you attend this service with your Spirit and let him give us eyes and ears to see and hear. We love you. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. To all who have gathered here this morning in this place, I want to welcome you into the presence of the Lord and his people. No sinner is too vile to be turned away. No offense is too great that Christ's blood cannot cover it and make you well this morning. Welcome to the house of God, and I want you to hear these words and let them call you to worship this morning. They come from Psalm 100. It says, "Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Amen. Let's celebrate his enduring love this morning as a church family. Let's stand together and sing his praises.
Give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 10 and 11 say, "Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities." He shall bear his own iniquities? No, he was completely sinless. He would bear the iniquities of sinners. Why? Well, we can't explain that, but the Father's eternal love for his children is so extremely amazing. Can we rejoice in that truth this morning as we sing this hymn together?
I can't.
And all God's people said, amen. Thank you for singing. You can be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the third chapter in the Gospel according to Matthew. We will begin reading in verse 13. Then Jesus came to Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answered him, Let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. This is God's word.
Thank you, Hannah. At this time, we'll dismiss our children to childcare. You may notice that we are abbreviating the music portion of our service on the front side. And the reason being is because today we are able to celebrate and partake in the Lord's table together. And being mindful of that, we want to make sure that that holds prominence in our service. And we want to give plenty of time for that. And so today I would like to just take the time to be able to go right into our message as we are looking in the latter portion of the third chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. The theme of this book, of course, is the King has come. It's written to Jewish people, and it is a historical, theological narrative. Matthew is serving as a historian, a biographer, and an interpreter to the life of Jesus. And that brings us to the point in which the Jews are waiting to hear. The King has come, and now the King is here. Here in their presence. Matthew introduced the Baptist, John the Baptist, as a fulfillment of Isaiah 40. He is the voice that was crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord. John calls these crowds outside of the city, unlike the prophets before, that would go into the city and preach the message that God had given them. He called the people out, away from the temple, away from the norm, into the desert. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. And last week, we looked at the very essence of what it means to repent. To change one's mind. To change the heart matter. To look at sin differently. To look at our lives differently, to look at God differently. John warned of God's judgment on Israel, and he called and begged them to do something that was new. Jews, be baptized. This was new because up until this point, baptism was reserved for Gentiles, remember. It was proselyte baptism. Those who were converting, who are identifying with the people of God. And here, the prophet, John the Baptist, is now calling even the Jews. And he said this, he said, listen, don't use the excuse that you are the sons and the daughters of Abraham. No, you must repent, for the King is coming, the Messiah. That brings us to our text today. A powerful ministry John the Baptist had. We do not know how long his ministry was underway. Some believe that he maybe possibly had a 6-month ministry. He being 6 months older than Jesus. And so maybe starting his ministry at 30 years old. Numbers chapter 4 gives us the impression that the adequate age for starting a ministry in the priesthood was 30 years. Of course, that was only for a short span because in Numbers 8, it was downgraded down to age 25. Some believe that he was 30 years of age. And for 6 months now, he has been preaching in the wilderness, in the desert. Repent, for the kingdom is at hand. In our passage that Hannah read earlier, it is described to us that Jesus now is on the scene Will you look back with me in the text? It says in verse 13 that then Jesus came from Galilee to Jordan to John to be baptized by him. This is intentional by Jesus. Jesus is now making a journey, some say approximately 60 miles on foot, to the Jordan to be baptized by John. It's very intentional here. This wasn't by happenstance. This wasn't a knee-jerk response by Jesus. This was on purpose. He is traveling now along the way, preparing to set the scene, to make his way onto the set for the greatest narrative, the greatest ministry to ever take place, to happen. Jesus here is now come to John, and he says, "Baptize me." That was the purpose. It wasn't to watch the baptisms, and then he says, "Okay, I want to be baptized." He came for that purpose. He came to not only affirm the baptismal ministry of John, but also to give us a picture, as we will allude to later, of what his ministry will be all about. His baptism, whenever he was stopped, he was halted by John. John says, "No, Jesus, I am not worthy to baptize you. You should be baptizing me." Such great humility by John the Baptist, but rightful humility. This same humility compelled him to say, "Of his shoes I am not worthy to hold. I'm not worthy to unlace them or to lace them up. I am not worthy to even be the lowest of slaves to this Messiah." As Jesus emerged now from the water, he sees the heavens open up. The Holy Spirit descends on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven declares that Jesus is indeed the Son, that he is pleased. The Father is pleased. Jesus' ministry has now not only affirmed and confirmed the ministry of John the Baptist, but now the Father has affirmed his Son and has revealed it to the entire world. That's a short narrative. It's only four verses today. We're intentional about that today, being with communion. But the words from heaven tell us a lot more. You see, the echo that he says in verse 17 is a combination of words from Psalm 2, when he says, "You are my son today. I have begotten you." It's also coupled and linked together now with Isaiah 42, the songs of the suffering servant. "Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights." The words of Psalm 2 indicate that Jesus is the promised Messiah King of Israel, the begotten of the Father, who will have the ends of the earth as his possession. This is the Son of God, who the rulers of this earth are to kiss, or they will perish. The words of Isaiah 42 give us a victorious king, but in order to be victorious, he must suffer greatly, and then he will triumph. He is anointed here in this passage by God's Spirit, which is a fulfillment of Isaiah 42. As indeed Jesus was at his baptism, he will not faint. He will not be discouraged until he has established justice on the earth. The suffering, which is only implicit in this chapter of Isaiah, and also in the text which was read earlier by Britt in Isaiah 53. There's prophetic implications here. This is another time that it must be fulfilled according to Matthew. Remember who he's writing to. He is writing to Jewish people who are very familiar with the Torah, who are very familiar with the Old Testament, the prophets, the law and the prophets. So remember, name that tune. He is giving this phrasing here. He's reminding, he's being very intentional here with what Jesus has done, because now the Rolodex in the brain for the Jewish believers or the Jewish people are now taking them back to the promises that their king, who is going to be of the lineage of David, is coming, and he will establish justice on this earth. Before we get to our main focus, let me give you some doctrinal clarification today. We see first time in the book of Matthew where all three members of the Trinity are involved in this moment. This is not a mode. This is not a oneness. This is three distinct persons in the same place at the same time, operating in different offices. We have the Son in human form, who is joined by God the Holy Spirit in a dove-like form, while the voice of God the Father calls down from heaven. This is one of the most potent examples of the mystery of the Trinity in all the Bible. Isn't it amazing? Those who deny the Trinity, who claim the oneness of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, meaning that they are just different manifestations. Well, how do you get out of Matthew chapter 3? We're not even three full chapters in to the New Testament, and already the Trinity. What God says in this moment makes the claim crystal clear. Jesus is the Son of God. This is another doctrinal clarification of the incarnation. He is deity. The baptism of Christ, let's clarify this today. The baptism of Christ was not him putting on righteousness and therefore qualifying him to be given deity. No, John puts that away. In the beginning was the Word. And from all of this, we see the person of Jesus Christ being the Son, the second person of the Trinity. This firmly confirms all who have heard it, that Jesus is indeed the Messiah, sent by God to fulfill the prophecies and begin to establish his earthly kingdom. John's words are ringing true now. John the Baptist's sermons are now a reality, and people now can see the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the King is here. But this gives us more than doctrinal clarification today. For today, as we are about to partake in the Lord's table in just a few moments, in just moments from now, we are going to now go from baptism to the Lord's table. And now today, we for just a few moments will be able to look into this gospel account of the baptism of Jesus. And we're going to be able to once again be confronted, to be comforted with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So how do we see this? How can we see that Jesus making this intentional travel from Galilee to Jordan to John to be baptized? How can we see, even in the humility or even in the passion of John, to stop Jesus from doing this, but for Jesus to then take authority and supersede the influence and the authority of the prophet in John the Baptist and saying, "Do this. This must be done." How can we take those things and then take the very act of Jesus going into the river? And immediately when he comes out of the river, behold, the heavens open up and the Spirit of God descends like a dove and it rests on him. And then that voice. How can the gospel give us this? How can the gospel give us comfort when Jesus is the one in which the Father says, "He is my beloved, and I am pleased in Him. He is my delight. How can we today cherish this? How can we look at the baptism of Jesus Christ differently? Jesus is now on the scene. And Jesus has gone 60 miles plus. And here we see a beautiful picture of number one in our main focus, that Jesus is a friend of sinners. It says, then Jesus came from Galilee. Remember that place? Or Luke gives us more detail of Nazareth. He comes here now, and he comes out of nowhere. He comes from nowhere. He comes from the overlooked place. He comes from the place that was not expected the Messiah to come from. He comes now, and he labors, and he travels, and he's intentional to come to John and to be baptized. But why is he a friend of sinners? Why would we take this from verse 13 and say, why do we see this as a friend of sinners? Because once again, as we even alluded to in chapter 1 of this gospel, here we see that Jesus goes to great lengths to identify with his people. Why did he come? To be baptized. Now, we need to backtrack for just a moment and establish here, why was John baptizing? What was this baptism? It was a baptism to confirm the message, right? Repent. It was a baptism unique in of it to itself, never to have been done before. Jews, God's people, people who have identified with the community of God, to repent of their sins. Which begs the question, why would Jesus go to great lengths to be baptized? A baptism of repentance. Why would Jesus do this now? Now, some have said that Jesus came to give us an example that we might to be baptized. Now, I think that that's an excellent reason to be baptized is because Jesus was baptized out of obedience. I believe that that is a good, I think that's a good reason to be baptized. To be able to, or to be mindful of that at least. But Jesus' example here is, Jesus is an example. But this isn't the only reason for this. In fact, it goes further than that. Jesus is coming now. And imagine with me the Jordan, where sinners have come in as a symbol of their repentance. So if they come into the water, what is the symbol of the baptism? To be cleansed. They confess their sin and they're cleansed. So what if you carry the illustration, then what has taken place? The sins of all the people have been left in the Jordan symbolically. And Jesus now goes and gets into the same water that all these sinners have gone into. And he has been covered by their sin. Paul alludes to this. Paul points out that the crucifixion of Jesus was a baptism. He became sin who knew no sin. Did Jesus come to be baptized to repent? No. How do we know that? What was the response of John? John says, you have no need to be baptized. You should baptize me. Jesus is a friend of sinners. What a picture now. Without even uttering his first word, his pursuit of his people, saying, I will come. I will get dirty. I will come. And I will be a friend to sinners. Number two, not only is a friend of sinners, we also see that Jesus is the sinless Savior. In verse 14, it says, John would have prevented him saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? That word prevented doesn't mean that he just said, I don't know about this, Jesus. It is a picture. In fact, there's strong language here. If you look in Matthew 16, remember when Jesus announced to the disciples that he was going to be crucified? And it says that literally that Peter pressed him. He stopped. He was stopping him. He was using this time to say, no, you are not going to do this. That's the same energy that John the Baptist is using here with Jesus. No, no. Because in his own mind he's saying, if you are to be baptized, that would imply that you have sin. And you don't need to be baptized. You need to baptize me. Let them see you baptize me, Jesus. But Jesus says, no. Do it, John. For it is fitting. Let it be done so that it be fitting to fulfill all righteousness. See, he's the sinless Savior. This admonishment or this refrain from John the Baptist implies here the recognition that this is, as John chapter 1 says, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Do you see what our first encounter with Jesus is? Already, he has already met with opposition. Even by the ones who love him. Jesus, this is a picture of his ministry over and over again. In fact, next week we will see even in chapter 4. Opposition. Opposition for what? Opposition not to be friends to sinners. But number three is where the opposition is met. To be a willing substitute. Jesus is the willing substitute. He says in verse 15, but Jesus answered him, let it be so now. Now! For thus it is fitting for us, talking about him and John. Why? Because this was intentional by Jesus. Jesus was not going to be baptized by just anyone. He was going to be baptized by John. That's what verse 13 says. He came from Galilee to Jordan to John to be baptized by him. He said, let it be so. What does this mean? Jesus has no need to be baptized. Jesus has no need to go into the water. This isn't about Jesus anymore. Jesus, use your sanctified imaginations here as he takes off the top robe and he begins to go down into the water. And all of these people are now watching as Jesus comes into the water. And Jesus looks. And now it is official. He is coming to be baptized, not for himself, but for his people. J.D. Greer uses an analogy that's powerful. He said, in order to put it into our imagination today, imagine that everyone who had been baptized had a name tag. And their name tag said, Teresa, sinner. Blake, sinner. Bobby, sinner. Every person had their name tag. And as Jesus walked towards the Jordan, he took their name tags and he put them on himself to show and to symbolize what his ministry was about. Oh, Jesus is a friend of sinners. And he's a sinless Savior. But he was the willing substitute. The doctrine of substitution that is marinated all through the Gospels, all through the Apostles' doctrine, that is preached from this pulpit week in and week out. When we give the beautiful gospel, what do we say? This was Jesus living the life that you could not live. And dying the death that you were condemned to die. All of this before he preaches his first message. He is the friend of sinners. He's the sinless Savior. He's the willing substitute. But lastly, he's the beloved Son. In verse 16 it says, "And when Jesus was baptized," when this symbol, when this foreshadowing, when this foretelling of his ministry took place, it says immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens opened to him. The heavens opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove. He was being anointed. 1 Samuel gives us this picture of what took place when their kings would assume the throne. What were they going to be? They were going to be anointed. He was anointed by the Spirit. It came and rested on him. And behold, that voice from heaven came. Now We know that the text and the Gospels only tell us that, they only give us the implication that Jesus was privy to what was going on. Now John was privy to some of it as well, according to the Gospel of John. But it says that a voice from heaven came, and we don't know. We know that they did not see the first, according to the text. And we don't know if they saw the second, but we know that Jesus saw it. Augustine says this was something very personal between the Trinity. This was intimate. This was something that the Father had to tell the Son. This is something that the Spirit had to do to affirm to the Son because of what was about to take place. It was intimate here. This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased. You see, Jesus' baptism was a foreshadowing. Indulge me for a moment. His submission to John's baptism of judgment points to his own baptism of judgment on the cross. Where the sufferings of the cross are identified in Mark chapter 10 and Luke chapter 12 by Jesus himself, he calls it his baptism. The declaration from heaven, a fulfillment of prophecy in Isaiah 42 and in Psalm 2, points to the fact that he will emerge victorious from his judgment. In the salvation of God's people, it will be achieved. It will be where the glory of God is revealed. The participation of each member of the Trinity is in salvation itself. As the Father sins, the Son suffers, and the Holy Spirit anoints and sustains. Hence, each member of the Trinity is presented to us in Jesus' baptism. As the Father speaks from heaven, the Spirit descends as a dove, and the Son is identified for us. So how do we apply this today? How do we take this? Jesus, a friend of sinners. Jesus, the sinless Savior, Jesus, the willing substitute, and Jesus, the beloved Son. How do we take this and go from narrative and doctrine to how do we take this and hang it like a key in our lives? How do we make this a reference point for us each and every day? How do we apply this? What does this do for us? Is the baptism of Jesus necessary for us to remember? Obviously, the Holy Spirit inspired Matthew for a wholehearted yes. You see, maybe today you're an unbeliever, and we're about to do something that is sacred, that is set aside, that is not for everyone. It is for His children. How do we do this? How do we partake in this? How do we receive this? The passage reminds us, if you're an unbeliever, reminds you today, confronts you, that you cannot be apathetic towards Christ. You see, hear the words of the Father. This is my Son. You see, there are only two options now. You either say, no, I reject Him, or you must embrace Him. There's no other way. You can't say, well, that's good for you. I'm glad that you're religious. I'm glad you worship the Son. But I will go to God another way. No. Get this. This is our application point for unbelievers. The Word of the Father preaches to us that there is no other way. There is but one Son. There is only one Son. He might as well have said, this is my only, unique Son. You hear Him. He's about to preach. He's the only way to the Father. Jesus even said it. When Thomas said, but how will we know the way? And Thomas said what? Or what did Jesus say to Thomas? I am the way. We must either reject Him or we must accept Him. We must embrace Him and find all the treasures that come with being a joint heir with Christ. What we do, believers today, if you are in Christ, if you have embraced the Lord Jesus Christ, the Heavenly Father, understand this. That promise that He delights in His Son carries over to you. Now you can hear the words of the Father. This is my beloved child. Oh, I'm proud of them. Oh, I love them. He delights in you today, believer, just like He delights in the Son. For you have become brothers and sisters in Christ if you are joined to Him, and the Father delights in you. That is your identity. And you will find even next week that the Satan will do whatever it takes to confuse you about your identity. He will attack your identity. He will point you to your past. He will point you to your mistakes today. He will point you of the uncertainty of the future. He will ask you, do you really think you can uphold favor with God? He will ask you all of that. But hear the words that is yours to claim, child of God. You are His beloved child. And He delights in you. You see, that's one of the hardest things for us to take in as believers, isn't it? That the Father delights in His children like that. But if you know Christ, if you've embraced it, if the Trinity has ministered in your soul, you don't have to be apathetic. And you don't have to be concerned. You don't have to wait for an appropriate time. Can I tell you, today is the time. Now is the acceptable time. Embrace God the Father today. Embrace God the Son. Embrace God the Holy Spirit. But it's all on Jesus. This was not only a declaration here in Matthew chapter 3, but this was a prophecy. This propelled us all the way. Remember, we have the luxury of reading this in light of knowing what the end of the story is. Jesus went in to the rivers of sin. He came to us. This is unlike any religion. Hear this today, child of God, as we are about to partake. Hear this. Jesus doesn't say, come and get as close to me as you can. He says, I have come to you. And the Father now looks at us and says, everything that is His is yours, including my affection. I love you. Please hear that today. You're a professing believer, and the noise of this world, the cares of it all, the distractions, the uncertainties, the doubts, they can be deafening, can't they? The hurt, but hear it. The heavens have opened. The Spirit has come. The Son has fulfilled all righteousness. And for you, child of God, today, your Father loves you. Jesus. All because of Jesus. This week I was ministered to by a song that I'm going to pull my phone out and read you some of the lyrics as this is coming to a stage near you. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like that I don't have enough. I still wrestle with it, even though I preach every week. I wrestle with, God, maybe I've done too much wrong. Lord, I lost my temper again. Lord, my eyes are wandering. Lord, I've said hurtful things. Lord, I hurt your sheep. Lord, how can you love me? And this week, this first line of this song just describes what I'm trying to convey to you, child of God, today. And for you, unbeliever, what I'm praying that you have the ears to hear this. When I fear, my faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. Oh, but he will hold me fast. Though he saves are his delight, Christ will hold me fast. heaven has opened up, and hear this, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He will not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. Believer, brother, sister, hear the words of Christ today. See the baptism of our Savior. He took your name tag, he put it on himself, and he went into the polluted waters of sin. And he was covered because you can't be saved without him. And he will hold you fast. Jesus, the friend of sinners. Jesus, the sinless Savior. Jesus, the willing substitute. And Jesus, the beloved Son. Let's bow together. With every head bowed and every eye closed, for just a moment, I would like for you to ponder. We corporately are about to partake. We're about to partake in the bread and of the cup. But we are warned to make sure that we do not do this in an unworthy manner. We must make sure that we do not come to this table thinking ourselves to be worthy, thinking ourselves to be able, thinking ourselves to be able to add anything to what Jesus has done. No, it is in Christ and in Christ alone our hope is found. But we've come today to worship. We've come to sing praises. And although Jesus has cleansed us and saved us, our feet have picked up the dust of the world. We wrestle with our sin. I'm asking you today, before we partake, to please confess as we pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we are people with unclean lips, unclean hands, and unclean hearts. We lower our heads before you. We confess that we too often forget that we are yours. Sometimes we carry on our lives as if there is no God. We have broken your laws many times without number. We cannot count. We are guilty of pride, unbelief, self-centeredness, and idolatry. Affect our hearts with the severity of our sin and the glory of your righteousness. As we now acknowledge our sins in your holy presence, we pray, O God, we have sinned against your mercies time and time again. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? How shall we answer you? We lay our hands on our mouths. We have no answer for your righteous wrath and your just judgment. For these things we ask your forgiveness. We also ask for your strength. And we pray now, Lord, that you give us a clear mind. You give us open hearts so that we will be reminded of who we are in Jesus Christ. Hold us to you and free us from shame and self-doubt. These things and more are the reasons that we need Jesus. His birth, his life, and his death, and his resurrection. And we pray this in his name, to which the people of God say, Amen. Will you stand for a moment with me and hear this? The Lord has done the work and bids us to come to his table to partake. And at this time, we invite you to come. What we'll do is we ask you come down the center aisle and gather your elements and then exit to the outside back to your seats. Will you come to the table now? Please come.
Take this morning. Can we stand and sing this song together?
You know I will.
Thank you for singing. You can be seated.
As we prepare to partake of the bread, let's pray. Our Lord, the bread that we're about to partake of is symbolic of the human body in which you dwelt incarnate among us, sinless, for 33 years. When you were crucified, you bore our sins in your body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. And by your wounds, we were healed. You took our place and paid a price that we could never pay, because before we loved you, you loved us. Seal this to our hearts as we eat the bread. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Church, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. And as often as you eat it, do this in remembrance of me." Before we partake of the cup, let's pray. Our gracious God, we thank you this day for the new covenant, the covenant sealed through the blood of Jesus the Christ. And we drink this cup in remembrance of his sacrifice for our sins, asking him even now through the Spirit to commune with us as we commune with each other. With grateful hearts, O Christ, we drink to you and of you. And it is in your name we pray. Amen. Church, drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Amen. Church, if you would stand with me as we close in song.
I was lost, I was blind.
He's worthy of all the glory, isn't he? Amen. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. You can consider yourselves dismissed.